capture an army that counts 3-1, a fortress and a state, hardly losing a man, will long be remembered a capital stroke and quoted uniquely the glory of Brock. That there is a quote by Sir Isaac Brock, a man so assured of his legacy that he was able to recognize that people in the future would be quoting him. I guess he was right. But what earned him the right to be quoted? What earned him his legacy? Let us look. And in order to look, we must first look at the United States 30 years after the American Revolution. The British were still up north in Canada, holding a few hundred untrained militia men, armed with snowballs, a lumberjack, a couple of grizzly bears, and maple syrup. The United States had manifest destiny, a home field advantage, and a massive army laying about, ready for a fight. So, why not conquer Canada? A natural choice. They're not doing anything, they're just being quite polite. So might as well let yourself in and conquer their land. However, a certain 42 Major General Sir Isaac Brock had a problem with this. A British general, fearless, borderline psychotic, and quite ready to take on the 3-1 odds in order to stop these Americans. He is quite possibly the only reason why Quebec and Ontario are part of the cucked Canadian state right now, and not an American state. Notable about Major General Sir Isaac Brock is that he was born in 1769, the same year as Duke of Wellington, Napoleon Bonaparte, and Carl Salomo Zachiare von Lingenthal. Yes, that's right, we all know him. The man who wrote the early seminal works on jurisprudence in the German Empire. All three are badasses, really, who deserve their own video. And I probably will give them that later on. Okay, maybe just the last badass of that list. The other two are rather well known. Brock was already known for historic stunts when it came to his military passion, such as being thrown to the floor by a cannon shell, only to again get up and swing his sword about as he charged the enemy lines. He also was known for capturing the entire city of Copenhagen with a single amphibious attack. Anybody who knows anything about amphibious attacks is that they are incredibly difficult to perform. Yet, he pulled it off. And for that, he was put in charge of all of the dozens of men in Upper Canada. Yeah, great. It was incredibly boring at first, until the Americans wanted to tango. That is when things went serious. Brock went on the offensive, building warships, preparing defenses, and even telling the newspapers that if the Americans conquered Canada, they'd sell the land to Napoleon, who would then come into town on a ship made out of bones of dead kings and personally sodomize every single Canadian he could catch. Whereas modern Canadians might have cheered at the idea of being sodomized, these Canadians were not so happy. About 4,000 of them were trustworthy with a weapon. However, the 11,000 civilian militia was not exactly up to par. However, the numbers were growing and he was getting ready for war, making alliances with some of the local Indian warriors, who were absolute badasses in their own right. The leader of these Native Americans, Tuquemesh, a balls-out, scalp-happy warrior with a brave outlook on life, took one look at Brock and said, "Ah, now this is a man." And then it began. June 18, 1812. The United States declares war on Canada. This was no surprise to Brock, who kept updated with the current times, but it was him against General William Hull of the United States, with far more men. Reinforcements would not be coming. The British government had said that Canada is undefensible. But that did not stop Brock, who right away encircled an entire regiment and surrounded it with artillery, thus making them surrender right away without even firing a shot. But victory would not be that easy. General Hull right away sent out 2,500 men into Canada against a force of merely 300 redcoats, 400 militia, and a few Indian warriors. Brock right away set out, going on horseback to defend the ground himself along with the men who he ordered to hold out. When he did join up and realized that the Americans had not met them there yet, he ordered them to just ignore Hull's army and just go around towards one of the forts that are nearby. More specifically, an American border fort called Mackinac had fallen without a single shot, surrounded by superior British Canadian forces. Hull panicked, recognizing that he was being outflanked as if it was a Hearts of Iron 4 game by a large British force, and immediately withdrew his entire army to the city of Detroit. Brock naturally surrounded it and laid siege to Detroit. No small feat, considering that the garrison inside the city outnumbered him 3-1, referencing the former quote that I started this video with. But this man didn't know how to stop. Brock continued to have the Indians swarm through the streets of Detroit, threatening General Hull and his wife, saying that he would have them killed by the thousands of Indians that were completely made up. Hull, however, completely bought into Brock's bluff and surrendered Detroit without firing a shot. Now, that seems to be a common trend here. And instead paid him 33 cannons, $60,000 worth of muskets, 2,500 men, and a warship, which was renamed to the HMS Detroit, presumably out of spite. For this victory, he was granted the title of Hero of Upper Canada, as well as being knighted by the Queen herself. He then made his way back to Niagara, where he took control of the defenses, repeatedly requesting permission to attack Buffalo, building up forts, and shifting men around, preparing the artillery for yet another battle. All went well until October 13, 1812, when General Brock received word that 3,000 men under the command of a new general had begun a large-scale invasion of the Niagara River, attacking the city of Queenston. Brock did not lay dormant, instantly getting up on his horse and riding the 7.5 miles to the battlefront in full speed. Once he arrived, he noticed how the Americans had taken on a powerful flanking position, and so what to do besides grab the 49th Regiment of Foot, a badly depleted company, and charge them uphill against these Americans. He, however, went ahead of the troops, who had barely even gotten up yet. He was waving his sword around, shooting his pistol, and got shot. Falling down, his dying breath, he screamed, "Press on!" to his men before dying. Inspired and impassioned, the 49th Regiment was able to capture the hill, turning the Americans back and preventing them from gaining a foothold for their invasion of Canada. To this day, in the memory of this legend, the spot where he died boasts a 200-foot-tall monument, marking the border between Canada and the United States.